广州这座面海而立于中国大陆南端，被海风吹拂过尽千帆的商都，从未停止过出走与回归。千年的开放与对外交流，留下历史的流年碎影与城市的机体相融，使人在当下的时空中不时回眸着那些闪亮的过往。在物换星移中，这抹闪亮的过往不仅折射出城市的荣光，也点燃了年轻人对于历史的好奇之心。
小时候特别喜欢邀请同学到我家一起玩，他们第一感觉我家其实很古怪吧，总是家里有一些年份很旧奇形怪状的一些东西。只不过当我去到别的同学家，哦，原来我们家确实很不一样，好像别人那种才是一个家，我自己家里因为摆放了这么多东西，更像一个博物馆。
2018年3月的一天，黄思恒遇见了同样对广州历史有好奇心的哈哈笑。
This is our studio.
So this is the place you were telling me about, huh?
We collect the map, some ancient books.
So all this stuff has to do with old Guangzhou, right?
Yeah.
Oh, awesome.
Seeing how did you get all these kinds of objects?
Yeah, actually they all from my father.
Okay.
He collected about 40 years.Show you something special.
黄思恒的父亲以毕生心血寻找到的每一件历史旧物，都是细数广州城市兴衰史的路标。这些沉默不语的物件，构筑成追溯这座城市过往的路径，引领着黄思恒与跨海而来的哈哈笑走进历史深处。
So this is the same one that we saw earlier,
yeah,
right?
In the beginning.
Cool.
That one is the Guangxiao Temple, the Yuexiu San.
Okay, so it's like Yuexiu Park up here.
Yeah, usually the foreign people, they're not allowing to enter the city.
Right.
So they have to live around behind a wall.
At this point, there's no 13 factories.
Yes, after like 200 years, then the 13 factory, they have a point at this left the bottom.
时光倒流300年，正是广州十三行贸易的鼎盛时期。广州城外洋船泊靠，商贾云集，其中最著名的商人就是十三行行商的领头人吴秉鉴。吴秉鉴创办了怡和行，经营丝织品、茶叶和瓷器，从事中西方的贸易。他是英国东印度公司最大的债权人，在中美通航后，他还扶持了美国福布斯家族。
There were stories that came down through my family. He was the person who took my great-great-grandfather and his brother under his wing and was responsible for their success.
Hakua was the most successful of the Han merchants. His investing $1 million, the richest man in the world,
in a number of industries, but chiefly in railroad.
当时清政府实施一口通商，广州成为唯一的对外通商口岸，广州十三行则成为清政府特许经营对外贸易的唯一机构，年上缴税银超过100万两。作为十三行行商领头人，吴秉鉴不仅创造了一个又一个的商业神话，还在与西方人的贸易合作中散发出人性的光芒。
In 1837, as you know, there was a disastrous economic collapse. One of my great-great-grandfather's colleagues owed a great deal of money to Hao Kua. We're talking $70,000. Realized he was stuck in China, essentially, for the rest of his life to try and pay that back. Hao Kua asked him to come into his office, and he tore it up, the IOU, in front of this man and said,Your family needs you. Go home.
After the 13 factory era, most of their trading facilities and storage houses moved across the river to Haumont. The major branches of the trading firms would open up offices here by selling things like tea and silk and some miscellaneous items from the west into China.
光阴流转，十三行在全球创下的商业传奇，至今仍吸引着来自世界各地的青年人。研读中国历史专业的哈哈笑自然成为了他们的引领者。回顾那段东西方贸易往来的历史，除了惊叹之外，他们自然生出对今天开放的广州更深的理解。
I am from the United States, and I was born in 1990. For Guangzhou, again, it's a lot of it just happened when I came here. I only knew it was the third largest city in China. My city's maybe 500,000 people, so I liked the idea of going to a much bigger place than my hometown.So when I came to Guangzhou, what I found that struck me a lot was the city has so much modern architecture and places, but it melded very well with more older parts of town. You know, it's very easy to go from one district to another, and it really is like you're changing time periods.
那个
Oh,
that's the
yeah.
part of the Xiamen building.
Yeah. This one is the Canton Club.
Yes, it is.
Today it's at that big yellow building that's next to the bank. The Starbucks is off on the.
这个年轻老外，开始我觉得他应该只是了解过一点历史，很惊讶。我给他看一些资料，他会很感兴趣，不停的去找。然后一个星期给我带来的就是那个人物背后的所有事情。
Wow, that's lost picture over there.
So then I just started plugging into Google. A lot of it is actually free, just nobody reads them. They're so outdated. It's not something most people tend to want to look for. Siheng really cares about Canton's history and preserving it and telling its stories. And that touches me very deeply to know that there are people here who do care.
What is your favorite about the Xiguan area?
西关，明清时属南海县管辖，因地处广州城西门外而得名。这里是广州近代对外贸易史上的重要地标，它不仅见证了十三行的兴衰，也见证了现代工业文明的到来。位于西关的荔湾区博物馆，曾是中国近代民族工业的先驱，南海纪昌隆缫丝厂创办者陈启源的家宅。1873年，陈启源创办了中国第一家民族资本经营的机器缫丝厂。机器替代手工，使广东生丝的出口量骤增。但这不是陈启源创造的第一个商业奇迹。在此之前的23年，陈启源赤手空拳来到越南西贡，凭着生存智慧，他买下了西贡的半条广东街。
陈启源的确是一个很特殊的一个人。他们说，哎，他不是说他是岭南七人吗？就是畸形的畸 ，abnormal man of South China。那然后我爸爸说，畸人是取自于庄子，畸于人而谋于天，就是跟常人不一样。
被称为岭南畸人的陈启源，在商业上同样具有独特的眼力。他在当时还处于殖民统治的东南亚考察时，第一次看到了法国的蒸汽缫丝机，便敏锐地感受到西方工业文明的脚步离我们越来越近了。于是靠观察和墨迹，他居然把这一技术带回了家乡。
法国人是不会给他的，因为他当时也是要技术垄断的嘛，所以也没有卖给他任何的机器，没有给他任何图纸，没有给他任何的指教。他是拿着一个自己的凭记忆拿画出来的这样的一些图纸回来，然后在南海这个地方请了一些刚刚开始做机器的朋友，大家一起钻研，做出了中国的第一台的缫丝机器。
开始大家都不觉得我爸他拿废铁之类的东西回来要干嘛，我妈觉得太陈旧了。 有几次就当垃圾扔掉了。但是我爸他很清楚自己在干什么，因为他在广州长大，不论这是一个电表或者保险箱，只要有广州两个字的，他都觉得很有价值。所有他收回来的很旧的物品，他总能发觉到里面的故事。
So this is like the science and medicine kind of corner over here.
Yeah, the bottom line, medicine.
Nice. This one looks interesting. What's this
yeah,
one?
Yeah, it's from a bank about the 1920. You insert the check and punch the area number.
Oh, so you turn it like this, right?
Yeah.
And then punch it here?
Yeah.
So is this foreign made or was this made here?
That is made from the U.S.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's it.
Oh. 黄思恒和哈哈笑见到的留存至今的西方舶来品，见证了那个东西方文明真正开始互动的时代。在十九世纪末、二十世纪初，西方的技术成果不断涌入国门之际，广东人戴宗汉则把东方的农业智慧送出了国门。1918年，16岁的广州仁和镇少年戴宗汉，买了一张最低等船票，登上了远赴秘鲁的轮船。初到秘鲁，生活异常艰辛。戴宗汉从杂工做起，经过20多年的打拼，积累到一点资本的他，开始垦荒种地。当时秘鲁人以土豆和玉米为食，少有人会问津米饭。在中国习以为常的炒饭，在秘鲁成了珍馐。当地的这种局面是因为缺乏水稻的种植技术。
秘鲁是一个缺水的国家，收成方面不理想。秘鲁人他们当时种植的饭很原始，用这个木棍啊，插一个洞，就放种子上去啊。
他有一个心愿，就是说，要是稻米普及在秘鲁。你靠自己几个农场不成气候，一定要老百姓都来种。
戴宗汉把中国的插秧技术传授给当地人，因地制宜修建弧形田基，解决缺水的难题，又广育良种，提高产量。
当时他们当农场丰收以后，人家都来学那个技术，老百姓来学，没钱买种子啊，买肥料啊，买工具啊，那戴宗汉就借钱给他们。很实在，他就一定要使你解决你的问题，把稻米种出来。结果呢，老百姓普遍种了以后呢，从秘鲁一个缺粮国变成了出口粮食的国家，这是他的一个很大的功劳。
Y para economizar el agua, creo que ahí así es curva de
curva de nivel.Sabe el agua.
Claro.
Mejor, pues, las cosas eran grandes y el agua lo mantenía muy bien. El agua.
戴宗汉把水稻种植普及到沿海和山区，因为他的特殊贡献，1968年秘鲁政府授予戴宗汉农业功臣勋章。
秘鲁政府从来没有颁奖过一个华人。
今天中餐厅在秘鲁有1000家之多。首都利马的每条街道几乎都有中国餐厅 Chifa。 Chifa 的名称源自粤语吃饭，在一家家 Chifa 里品味着炒饭的秘鲁人不会忘记他们国家的水稻之父，来自中国广州的戴宗汉先生。
秘鲁人对炒饭真是男女老幼个个都喜欢，而且百吃不厌。我们在秘鲁做中餐馆呢，首先我们接受了老祖宗留给我们的遗产，就是那个稻米。以前呢，秘鲁餐桌上面秘鲁人吃的就是土豆、玉米，现在呢就什么饭都有，都很喜欢。连他甜品也是用牛奶跟那米饭来做的甜品，这个情况只有秘鲁有，别的国家我没见到过。
千年的开放之风留下的 不仅是商业传奇和科技成果，更是先贤们馈赠的精神财富。黄思恒父亲收藏的一个个老物件，似乎隐藏着历史的文化密码，使老人家钟情一生。
那天是4月30号，我还在机场，接到我妈电话，说：“你快点回来吧，爸爸没了。”那时候我没反应过来，我听到我妈很崩溃的说的那句话，头脑一片空白，我不敢想要面对的一个事情是什么样的。我跟我爸价值观非常不一样，他不喜欢坐车，他不喜欢坐我开的车，他是一个去哪里都喜欢搭公交车坐地铁的一个老人家。永远让我对他最深刻的那个是那他转身进去地铁的那个背影，拿着个环保袋，感觉他很孤独，他好像很害怕这些东西会消失了。其实他对每一件产品都有感情，我没有问过他最喜欢哪一件，但是他问过我一句，你以后会怎么对待这些东西？我说我一定帮你好好保管，我不会把它们卖掉。And this one is the China illustration. It's a different year, like the 1840.
Wow.、Yeah. Okay. So we're about a couple hundred years later then.
Yeah.
Ooh, this is interesting.
Yeah, that is the opera.
But it looks like you、yeah. take a look at the faces.
They are having a high nose and small eyes. That's
yeah.
What the foreigners recognize Chinese is.
Yeah, it definitely is not、
yeah.
Asian features.
Because he never been to China, so.
Oh, yep. So it's kind of a combination of、yeah. what details he does know with sort of thinking、
exactly.
about this.
Yeah. Yeah.
How are Cantonese people different from, say, other people in China?
I would tell like, the Cantonese more concerned about like, the food、
uh-huh.
and the place.
人们常说食在广州，它体现了广州独具特色的饮食文化。粤菜是岭南文化的重要组成部分。除此之外，还有功夫、舞狮、舞龙等，这些中华传统文化也随着下南洋的商船来到东南亚，并在华人家庭落地生根。农历新年是海外华人华侨最隆重，也是保留最完整的传统节日。
祝我们的大家庭身体健康，万事如意，一起恭。
千百年来，一批又一批的广东人下南洋经商，在下南洋的商船上，就有印尼最大的零售和进口商常有集团的创始人王华岩。1938年，王华岩来到印尼，凭着精湛的手艺和吃苦耐劳的秉性，他在唐人街开设了一间10平方米的五金店。
螃蟹回来不是回家，就是到店里吃碗，在那边一搬碗一搬看我爸爸卖东西，我在那边旁边看他们的手势，他的动作，你可以吸收了不少的 lesson， 在跟我爸爸之间学到了怎样做的，怎样去做生意。
在黄华岩的苦心经营下，五金店逐步壮大。1976年，王华岩正式把长友五金店交给了20岁的黄一军和他的兄弟姐妹们。
从我爸爸传留下来的一个印象，兄弟姐妹要团结，各有各的优势，各有各的缺点，变成一个 very strong, very powerful team， 很强的一个团队。这种气氛一直延续到今天，成为我们大家族的精神财富。
年年有余，大吉大利，步步高升。
我开始好像一个小鸟开始可以飞了， 在去国外找产品，跟人家接触，学了不少。
黄一军所说的去国外找产品，就是与广交会的结缘。20世纪90年代初，针对当时印尼经济发展的状况和人均的消费能力，黄一军在寻找贸易伙伴时，把目光投向了中国。1995年，黄一军第一次参加广交会，从那年开始，他年年都来，至今已坚持了整整23个年头。
我第一次参加广交会的时候是1955年，广交会是在柳花宾馆，在那边人山人海。我记得那时候跟中国做生意是不容易的事，去看产品当场要下个订单，回来了很难的，因为那个电话啦、fax 啦都很难的沟通。
1957年，第一届中国进出口商品交易会在广州应运而生。在很长的时间里，广交会成为中国对外贸易的主要渠道，也成为海外华人华侨与祖国联系的重要窗口。
1995年，从那个开始，我每6个月来一次。现在的广交会比过去的已经大大的不一样，很惊讶中国的发展。中国的产品很适合印尼这样的发展中的国家。几年前，中国的货就是说低档货，便宜，用不着几次就坏掉，但是这个印象现在已经变了。
So before you came, what would you expect that Guangzhou is?
So I didn't think Guangzhou would be as big as it is now.
I think for most Americans, especially if you were born in the 90s, probably understanding we have of China was probably through movies like Mulan. In my mind, China is a very ancient place, and we really didn't know much. So when I was coming out here, I had this very vague concept of what life might be like out here and, you know, what might be different from what I had imagined.
Last time, you might be missed our exhibition. I can show you right now in the VR.
Oh, cool. Yeah,
that's the whole angle.
Oh.
我们一直想旧的物品怎么去创新，让更多人容易的接受。特别在我们这一年代的人，80后、90后，大家最忙的就工作，忽略的东西特别多。Lots of research.
So this is where you're going to be telling the story about?
Yes, this is our new exhibition here.
I think what Siheng and I are doing is continuing a tradition that started since the late 1700s. We've had merchants and people coming and learning about China and Canton. It's really the first time you have two sides of the world meeting each other. I find it cool that I'm kind of part of history, really, as I'm doing the same thing that they were doing.
从古代的海上丝绸之路到近代十三行，从现代工业文明的肇始到广交会的互通有无，千百年来，广州这座临海之城往来翻影从未停歇。文化和贸易上的开放，造就了这座古老商都海纳百川的城市气质。当新时代的改革开放来临，当中国再一次与世界相拥，这个得风气之先的城市依然走在了前沿，因为这一刻，广州已经准备了千年。